You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV. Television Addict! Television Addict!
Television Addict! Good morning, good evening, good Saturday, whatever this may be. I hope you have a large bowl of some sort of monster cereal with you. Perhaps Frankenberry, maybe some blueberry, maybe Count Chocula, whatever it may be. Please enjoy your Halloween spirit. I know it is somewhat early, we're a couple weeks before, but I wanted to give you plenty of time to listen to this episode and to have time to watch all of the Halloween suggestions that come out of today's special 2016 TV Guidance Counselor Halloween Edition. As always, I am Ken Reed. I am your TV Guidance Counselor, and I want to thank you for joining me on the show today. I am also on the Dana Gould Hour's Halloween special today. That is probably my favorite podcast, and I always look forward to the Halloween episode every year, so it was an absolute honor to appear on the show. I cannot thank Dana enough for having me on. So if you are checking this show out because you heard me on that show, welcome. My name is Ken Reed, and I am the TV Guidance Counselor. This is the show where we look at the difficult television choices of our past using old editions of TV Guide as our entryway into our memory banks. This episode this week is a little bit different, a little atypical. We do not actually use a TV guide, but we do talk about television traditions, TV, what we watch on Halloween. My guest is good friend of mine, an incredibly talented artist, Mr. Sam Furst. Sam is the owner, proprietor, creator of Monsters Are Good, a fantastic t-shirt emporium. He designs great monster shirts, so since we're a little early before Halloween, you have plenty of time to buy some and wear them on Halloween. Sam is a great guy. I also want to thank you if you are checking out my show for the first time because you heard me on Doug Loves Movies or you heard Doug on my show yesterday. It is a fun show, and I want to thank Doug for being on that show as well. This is our 2016 Halloween edition. If you enjoy it or you want to listen to other Halloween editions of the show, last year, 2015, I had comedian and good friend Lamont Price on the show. Lamont and I watched the made-for-TV movie The Midnight Hour, and it's a watch-along episode, so we check back in on the commercial breaks and discuss the episode. Hopefully Lamont will be back on the show soon. Always love talking to Lamont. He's a great guy. And the 2014 Halloween episode was me flying solo and giving you guys recommendations for things to watch on Halloween. So those are both available on iTunes still or anywhere where podcasts are sold, I suppose, for free. So you can listen to those as well. On to this week's episode. First and foremost, this is a very special episode for many ways. In one being that this is our first sponsored episode. We don't have ads on the show. We haven't in the past. We most likely will not in the future. But this episode is sponsored by a very special event, and I will read it in the manner of Charlie Brown's Halloween episode sponsorships, or the Great Pumpkin sponsorships, or any of the variety of TV specials you've seen over the years. The TV Guidance Counselor Halloween special is brought to you by Chris Hardwick, The Idiot Tour, at Boston's Wilbur Theater on November 4th. Two big shows at 7:30 p.m. and 10 p.m. Tickets available at thewilbur.com. So go to Chris's show. You will enjoy that show. Go to both. Why not buy tickets for both shows? There's probably some still available. I don't know, but you should go. And before you go, you should listen to this episode of TV Guidance Counselor, our Halloween special. So please enjoy the Halloween special as we watch the film Black Roses with Sam Furst.
I'm doing good. How are you, Ken?
Good. Thank you for coming to the home. You've been here several times, though.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Been every crevice of this house.
Yeah, Sam did a personal version of a, like, hoarder's intervention and helped me clean out some junk from the basement.
I'm hoping that you'll return the favor one day and come help me in my basement.
Yeah, but what Sam doesn't know is that I'm just going to move everything from my basement to his basement.
Oh, God.
Yeah, although that is an odd favor to ask, basement favors, because you never really know what... Just knowing a person for a long time, even, you don't know what their basement's like.
That's true. Basement is a personal space.
Do you have a dirt floor basement? Do you have an old house, too?
Yeah, it was built in 1866. No, they actually, they must have poured concrete floors at some point in like maybe the 60s is my guess.
Oh, there's bodies under there then.
Oh, no doubt.
Yeah, there is absolutely like an ex-wife or like a daughter no one talked about under there. There has to be.
Well, part of the basement actually has like a wood floor.
A wood floor?
Yeah.
Why would you have a wood floor in a basement?
I don't know.
It gets Underground Railroad?
It's super cold, and there's a couple spots where the boards are broken and just like...
What's underneath it? Have you looked?
No.
Is it hot? Is there like a space under there, or is it just...
There's definitely at least 6 or 7 inches of clearance.
Oh, so there's a crawl space under there.
I don't know.
For a very flat person. It could have been pizza storage back in World War II when they would tax people's pizza.
Yeah.
They would hide it in their basement.
There is a pizza place right behind my house.
Yeah, like, well, that would make sense.
Even the rodents, the wild rodents all have pizza.
Yeah. Well, that's good. If they weren't eating that pizza, it would prove that that's terrible pizza.
That's true.
So we both share an affinity for horror films and that sort of thing.
Oh, yeah.
But were you ever a believer in those things? Like, are you one of those people who's, you know, seen a ghost?
I think maybe at one point I did, like, I was a little superstitious about it all.
Right.
But when I was little, my brother and I were obsessed with Ghostbusters.
Right.
So we would dress as Ghostbusters all the time. And one of the best stories is that we... decided that we were going to be really badass, and we dressed up as Ghostbusters and then had our parents take us to a haunted house in the Worcester area. And, of course, we got carried out crying.
This was around Halloween. This wasn't just, like, the old haunted Magooan mansion, you know, in Castle Hill.
Oh, something. Yeah. No, my parents were just like, this is an abandoned house. We're going to drop you off here. We'll pick you up in about a half an hour.
Those ain't ghosts.
No.
That would be terrifying. But what was the first sort of horror movie kind of thing that you saw? Because you're the oldest, right?
No. My brother's 2 years
older.
Your
brother's older than you.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's much smaller than me. But,
he's smaller. That's what
But he
what
is
thought, yeah.
2 years older than me.
Okay.
And I feel a little bad because, you know, when my brother would get privileges as we were growing up, it would kind of trickle down to me too.
Right.
Even though he was 2 years older, I would still get to do whatever he was doing.
So he suffered for 2 extra years so that you could get the benefit of that sort of thing.
Yes.
Well, that's what younger siblings get, and that's why they're the worst. I'm the oldest, so
yeah. What are you gonna do?
So he was into that stuff first.
Yeah, I think, you know, I had brief touch points with like horror movies and stuff like that. I remember catching my babysitter watching, I want to say, Freddy's Dead. And it was, and the reason I know it was Freddy's Dead because it was the scene where she's hitting her abusive father and his face is getting all deformed.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's a really weird part.
That absolutely is. Yeah.
So it's like, I know that's what that was. I want to say probably about 4th grade.
Okay.
My brother really started getting into horror. So we got to see all of the Nightmare on Elm Streets. Actually, you know what? To tell you the truth, one of the first, like, full-on, like, I watched it start to finish horror movies that I ever saw was Halloween. It was a TV edit. Just, like, kind of came on. And I was like, wow, what is this? And I watched it, and that's still one of my favorites.
It's great. That movie, there's not really that much cut out for the TV edit. Because it's a pretty bloodless movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's mostly, you know, like, PJ Souls.
They cut out PJ Souls' souls.
Yeah.
But that, I mean, the movie really has very little cut out of it when it's usually shown on TV and works really well because it's such a suspenseful, creepy movie. That's absolutely one of the best horror movies.
Yeah, I mean, it works like a Hitchcock movie where it's like you don't need to see the gore to know that it's kind of scary.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's terrifying. I still watch that movie every October. Actually, I usually watch the first 3. That's kind of where I stop with the Halloween movies. And where would the horror movie industry be without babysitters who were irresponsible in the movies and also exposing children to things they shouldn't see? Many of us, because did your parents have rules around things you could watch and not watch? Were they like, this is too scary?
They were relatively lax about things. They weren't looking at it now. I mean, because now I have an 8-year-old daughter, and a lot of the time I'm like, I still don't know that I would let her watch something that I watched when I was 8 years old.
Right.
But, you know, because when I was a kid, like I had a TV edit off of RoboCop.
Right.
And like, but I didn't know that it was a TV edit. And, I went to a friend's house for a sleepover, and the following morning, he was like, "Oh, you want to watch RoboCop?" I'm like, "Sure."
Seen it a million times.
Seen it a million times. He puts it on, and it's like, it's the full-on RoboCop. Oh, yeah. And I was like, "Oh my God, what is this?"
This is very violent.
And the moment when his hand gets blown up, I'm just like, "Oh."
Yeah, that is probably one of the most gory movies of the 80s and 90s.
Well, that scene is like particularly brutal.
But in the end too, when the guy gets in the toxic waste and
I don't think we made it that far because I like murders went home,
the executive and shoots him 7,000 times. Like, that really is, there are a bunch of action movies that are definitely gorier than many of the horror movies from the 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
That being one of them.
The first, probably around, I know for a fact it was third grade. I was obsessed with Terminator 2.
Right. As well you should be. So that this is when it came out. This was 92. So I was 12, and I think
it was definitely
younger than me.
It was definitely when it was on video.
Okay.
So it was probably like later that year or whatever.
Right. So you were what, 6 and 92, so probably something like that. How old are you in third grade? 8? How old is third grade?
Yeah, 8.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So it would have been like a year or two after it came out.
Yeah. So when it was one of those movies that, it's about like a hero robot man who rides a motorcycle and has a leather jacket. And it was like, I thought it was the coolest thing ever.
When you're a huge fan of Lorenzo Lamas's Renegade.
Obviously.
Did you ever see that?
No.
Oh, that was about, he wasn't a robot, but he drove around with a leather jacket on a motorcycle, no shirt usually, ponytail, and basically solved crimes with his American Indian sidekick. Hmm. I guess, actually, now that I've mentioned, it's not anything like Terminator 2.
No.
It was a leather jacket and a motorcycle.
But I mean, also that movie was like, I mean, that's like an incredible movie for special effects and like things like that, which I mean, I was always really fascinated with because, I mean, I was obsessed with Monster Squad when I was a kid.
Right.
And I mean, monsters in general. I mean, obviously, like it's deep in the fabric of who I am.
Yeah. I think there are just certain kids that are wired for monsters. Mm-hmm. Like you gravitate towards them. And I think yours is probably generational too, because your dad is really into that stuff too, didn't he?
Yeah, but that's actually something that I never really knew about him extensively until more recent years.
Right.
Where it's like I started showing him much deeper interest in these things, so he kind of like would talk to me about
it. Right. But you don't have any like fond memories of bonding over as a kid over like, you know, Godzilla movies or anything like that.
Not particularly. I mean, we would watch Pee-wee's Playhouse all the time. And like, I mean, he would stick around and watch those with us. Like, that's my memories of Saturday mornings was my mom would make these like cinnamon stick things and we would watch Pee-wee's Playhouse.
That's a pretty good Saturday.
But as far as like, I mean, he would always take us to go see those movies, like the weird, like the Spawn movie and things like that.
Like the witches. Did you ever see the witches? The Roald Dahl movie?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, terrifying.
That is a horrifying movie.
Oh, yeah. That's one of the scariest movies ever.
But I think I've told you this story before, but when I was in third grade, and the reason that I associate Terminator 2 so closely with it was that I was so obsessed with Arnold Schwarzenegger that we had to do a book report on a biography.
Yeah.
And I managed to find an Arnold Schwarzenegger biography.
Not an autobiography.
No. Which probably would have been amazing.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
But no, it was actually made for kids. And
Scholastic. That would have been Scholastic. Troll Book Club couldn't have afforded.
I think I got it out of Scholastic. The little paper.
Yeah.
I think I got it out of that. And I was like, okay, well, I'm going to do like a paper mache bust of Arnold Schwarzenegger. So I started doing it. My mom was helping me. She's like, oh yeah, you do your thing.
She's an art teacher? Is your mom
My mom was a public school art teacher for kindergarten through eighth grade.
What a conflict for her, where she's like, I don't like the Terminator, but I want to encourage his artistic ability.
She didn't necessarily... Well, she liked those movies, too. Actually, my mom... While I was growing up, my mom was always really into Stephen King.
Okay.
So she was always reading Stephen King novels.
Yeah.
Stephen King is the reason that we moved out of our house in Westwood. We lived right on 109 in Westwood.
Right.
Do you know Bubbling Brook in Westwood?
Yeah, excellent black raspberry ice cream at Bubbling Brook.
We lived like three houses down from Bubbling Brook.
It's a busy, busy road.
Busy road. My brother and I, we had our like these little bikes. I was probably, 1 year old. My brother was probably 3.
Gauge age.
Yeah, exactly. And she was reading Pet Semetary, and she was like, we got to get out of here.
That is a grim book. I weirdly been thinking about this a lot lately, and it might just be because I was you know, watching Stranger Things over the summer. But Stephen King is something that I read a lot as a kid, and I kind of wish that I hadn't. Because it definitely profoundly negatively affected me, I think.
Negatively?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and it might have just been because I was an overly sensitive kid who was kind of open to that sort of stuff anyway, and maybe anything I read would have negatively affected me. But really, just like the Pet Semetery is one of the most depressing books I've ever read.
Oh, it's
in my
life. The movie is depressing too.
Oh, absolutely. And the book is even worse.
It seems like it's one of those movies where it's like, I'm like, yeah, you know what? I feel like watching Pet Semetery. No. And then as soon as I start watching it, I'm like, oh God.
It's not fun. It's not. No. I love horror, and I've realized as I've grown older that I don't want the kind of horror movie that actually disturbs me.
Yes, and I will say this, that as I've gotten older, that's definitely been the case for me too, because I spent, you know, the better part of my teen years and my college years, I loved really ridiculous gory movies.
Yeah.
And I don't have any desire to watch them anymore.
Well, even gory stuff though, like, you know, it could still be fun because it'd be so ridiculous, like Dead Alive. Or
yeah, it's, you know. But see, that's a different, I feel like that's a totally different level.
Like, what were some of the ones that you would watch that year? Like the Saw movies? Or
No, I never got into those. But I mean, even some like the weird, like, I mean, like the rape revenge movies and things like that.
Yeah.
I just, like, it was, I hit a point and I was just like, none of this, like, I mean, even the trauma movies, like, to a certain extent, like, I just kind of was just like, I can't enjoy this anymore.
Yeah,
and
stuff
it's like
Miss 45 Day of the Woman, I Spit on Your Grave, and that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And I was just, I got to a point, and I mean, really, that's sort of where, you know, Monsters Are Good came out of, which was that it was this kind of turning around for me where I was finding myself relating to those movies a little bit more and finding a lot more joy in watching what could be considered a scary movie, but it wasn't a gross movie.
Yeah. I, you know, and this ties to horror on TV, I think a lot too, because I've, as far as the stuff that I revisit a lot, it tends to be a lot of the horror TV shows and a lot of the anthology shows. Mm. And part of the reason for that is that they have to be allegories. They have to be, because they can't show a rape revenge thing, and they can't show something really horrific, or they couldn't when we were growing up. You know, it's a little bit different now. But even Tales from the Crypt, which was fairly gory, you still had to do an allegory. You couldn't just do a horror movie about a woman raped by eight guys who goes out and castrates them all. Like, that is horrific, but I don't really want to see that. Like, I want to see an allegory. And monster stuff is inherently an allegory, whether it's intentional or not. And so because of that, you can kind of choose to watch the movie in several different ways, or the thing in several different ways.
Yeah.
You can just enjoy it for the crazy funness of it. You can enjoy it on more of a sort of cultural studies level.
Yeah.
And that's the stuff that I gravitate towards. I don't like seeing just horrific, grim violence.
It's when the gore becomes the spectacle, and it's not just a byproduct of the story. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because that's where I think, like, horror movies in general have gone totally wrong in the past, you know, 15 years. And like movies like Saw and anything that Rob Zombie does and anything like that, it's not enjoyable. It's just kind of squeamish, and it's not, it doesn't make you,
you feel bad after. You don't feel like you've had a cathartic relief experience. You feel bad after.
It's yes.
Like, even, I think, like, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, which I actually prefer to the first one, is kind of approaching that sort of thing, but still has a weird, crazy level of fun bizarreness because it's so
well,
over the
I
top.
Mean, you throw Dennis Hopper in it with...
Yeah, it's
coked
nuts.
Out of his mind with a chainsaw. Yeah. It's going to be a fun movie.
But you can see the seeds for the late 90s, 2000s sort of horror stuff coming in there.
I think, I mean, obviously the later Texas Chainsaw Massacres totally just became slasher films. The first two are kind of like, they're very strange movies because they're both very different.
Well, the first one's a fairy tale.
First one is a Hitchcock movie.
I think it's more like Hansel and Gretel.
Well, I mean, it's that like we were talking about before, it's that you don't need to see everything for it to be terrifying.
Right.
And it's the the lo-fi way that they executed that movie, that it really works as being kind of like chilling and eerie.
Right.
And Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 is a much more polished movie. It's very Hollywood, and it's, but it's fun.
Yeah. It's totally fun. For it. I mean, that the opening scene with the Oingo Boingo song and the,
well, I love the puppet. The puppet is amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just really, but, you know, I started thinking about what I was saying, where it's like the gore becomes the spectacle. And it was, I was trying to think of anything in the past 15 years that I really enjoyed that I saw in the theater. And I started thinking about the Evil Dead.
The remake?
The remake,
which I've not seen.
You've not seen that?
No. And have you seen, have you watched Ash vs. Evil Dead?
I saw the first episode.
I really like the pilot.
I really, really like that. I heard that the first two episodes are awesome. It gets a little slow, but then the last four episodes of the first season are like bonkers.
Okay. I'll have to see it.
I have, yeah, I just haven't sat down to watch it. But the Evil Dead remake, which is not really a remake, is phenomenal.
All right. I'll have to watch it then.
It was one of those movies where I was like, I was so resistant to it. I was just like, well, just why are you doing that?
Yeah.
It just doesn't need to be done. It's going to be not what it doesn't. It's not right. going
to
have that.
We
essence.
Don't need to do that. We already have the other one.
And I'll say it's a harder movie.
Mm-hmm.
It is relentlessly gory, but there's some amazing like core to that movie.
Yeah.
And it, I mean, it comes because it's written by Sam Raimi and Bruce Campbell.
Yeah.
So it has people behind it who know what they're doing, giving somebody else a chance to, like, put it on film.
Right, and you need good characters. I mean, I think that's what we miss a lot of these movies, too. And one of the reasons that some of my favorite horror stuff has been on television the last few years, even stuff like Supernatural, which kind of scratches that fun itch of that sort of thing,
yeah,
which can get absolutely ridiculous and suffers too much from a low budget sometimes when, you know, there are dragons that are just played by people, and they have to go, oh, well, dragons can take human form, or, you know, whatever it is, because they can't show it. There's still some fun crazy horror stuff in that, and yeah. You know, two of the most horrific episodes of television that I've seen were episodes of Fringe. There's one called Marionette that's just chillingly terrifying.
I started watching that show because of you.
Yeah.
I just haven't like really gotten into it.
Were you like just in the first season?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very slow intentionally, and then it picks up big time.
Yeah.
But some of the best horror I've seen is in that, and part of it is because of the characters are so strong. So you have that sense of dread, and you worry about what's going to happen to them instead of just, oh, that's gross.
Well, I mean, Buffy did that really well, too. And Buffy had some fantastic character design,
right.
which was always like really appealing to me about that show. And I mean, Supernatural has that, too. But like episodes like The Gentleman,
mm-hmm.
like those are great looking characters. Like they're really cool.
And were you like a subscribe to Fangoria, you know, get monster makeup tutorials kind of kid or?
I mean, I never did the magazines.
Mm-hmm.
It was never something that like I really found a great deal of joy in. Occasionally I would find an issue that interests me and I would read.
Yeah.
Like, you know, the articles that really were calling to me.
So you're saying you got the magazines just for the articles?
I guess
yeah,
so.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, it wasn't until later on that like I could really appreciate some of those magazines. I was always obsessed with special effects. I mean, when I was little, I had like the behind the scenes of Thriller.
Yeah. That VHS tape was really important to a whole generation.
Yes. And it was one of those things where when I was little, everybody loved Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
So it was not something like out of the norm, but that behind the scenes stuff, like gave me this whole other understanding of how movies were done. And I found it so incredibly fascinating.
Yeah. I think if we can just take a side note for a second here, that making of Thriller, which aired before the video premiered in 1983 or 84 on MTV, was one of the first shots I can remember in the war that was eventually won by horror becoming mainstream. And it was really weird, and it was so classically horrific. And then it's the first thing I can remember, and I'm sure someone will write in and tell me if I'm wrong, that did show you how they do latex special makeup effects, you know, how they'd make a zombie, how you make a werewolf transformation. And then after that, we got a million shows that showed us that after. There was Discovery Channel had a whole show on that. Yeah. And, you know, there was a making of everything after that.
And I remember always being excited when there was a making of something.
Yes.
And my parents would always like record it if it was on late and let us watch it. And those, I mean,
The Dark Crystal was a big one. I remember they always said the making of The Dark Crystal aired.
I'm trying to think of some of the ones that I've seen. I mean, a lot of them are for like really boring movies that like really didn't need a making of, like Richie Rich and things like that.
Yeah, that's not very exciting.
But I do remember specifically them talking about like building the computer generated bee.
Right, right, right.
The remote control bee.
I remember a making of Hocus Pocus.
I remember that one too, yeah. Actually. Yeah. And it's funny to think about things like the Thriller and even the Hocus Pocus one, because those are still extraordinary, like so relevant.
Yeah.
You know, the Thriller one, especially to me, because it's Rick Baker.
Yeah.
And it's like, I never in a million years when I was a kid would have known like what kind of, affection I would have for that man as a grown man or as an adult. And I mean, Rick Baker is one of the most talented makeup artist that has ever come.
He's just a talented artist. Like his paintings are amazing. Like
do you watch his YouTube videos?
No, I haven't. I should check him out.
He has a YouTube channel and he does just like painting makeup on himself and on his daughters. And he does like painting, like oil painting. And he does.
Well, at Halloween Town, which I think you're not supposed to take pictures in there, but I took some pictures on Magnolia Boulevard in Burbank, which I was texting Sam pictures the last time I was there, because Halloween Town is four stores. There's a kid specific one. There's just one for decor. It's a crazy Halloween stores, and Creature Features and Dark Delicacies are all right near it. But Halloween Town has like a, I guess you'd call it like their high end vault room. And they have original oil paintings by Rick Baker in there for sale.
Geez.
And so just looking at them, I mean, they're photorealistic oil paintings of Frank. And I think last time we were there, they had the Jack Pierce, Boris Karloff, Frankenstein's monster.
Yeah.
And then he did one of the Glenn Strange Frankenstein's monster. And they were unbelievable. And it was so cool to see them, you know, close up and in person. And it really was moving in the way that people get moved when they go to like an art gallery and see like a Monet or something.
Yeah. It for people like you and me, things connected to pop culture and movies and specific people, you know, it's amazing what kind of power that they can have over our emotions.
Oh yeah. It takes you by surprise as well.
Yeah. Well, I told you the story about going and seeing, you know, all the Star Wars stuff in New York and getting like overwhelmed with this like rush of emotions as soon as I saw C-3PO and R2-D2.
Yeah. Cause it's really them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I wonder, you know, when I see so many things that are CGI now, you can't go see a CGI prop, you know, is there going to be that sort of thing for like your daughter? Although your daughter, you've kind of programmed correctly for some classic stuff. Did you have like when you were growing up, did you and your brother have like a Halloween ritual? Did you have like a movie you watched every year, or was there something you sat down and did for Halloween?
Ernest Scared Stupid was on a lot.
That is a good Halloween movie, because you're younger than me. So that was probably airing on like ABC Family. 13 Nights of Fright would usually air that.
I'm not that young.
But that was in the 90s.
Yeah, I mean, ABC Family didn't roll around, though, until, like...
Well, it was the Family Channel before that.
Yeah, but, I mean, we would always rent it.
Oh, okay,
We had a great video store in the center of Norfolk, which is the town I grew up in, that is no longer there, sadly, as none of them are.
No, there are very few video stores.
Isn't there just... There's one in California.
There's one Blockbuster in California.
There's a Blockbuster video.
Yeah, there's some mom-and-pop ones around it. Like, vacation towns usually have them, like, people who are, you know... I have a summer cabin. They'll usually have, you know, VHS.
That's a really good idea. Stuff. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah.
I was trying to think of a way to open a video store.
Yeah, vacation towns, because they usually don't have Wi-Fi, so people can't stream stuff.
Mm.
And they need, like, some rainy day, you know, we'll rent a couple of movies. And so whenever I've seen them still, it's in, like, Maine, New Hampshire, or by a lake or something like that.
Very cool. That's about the only movie that I can really think of.
Okay.
You know, I mean,
that's a good Halloween movie.
It is. It's a fun one. I remember when we were kids, we had one Halloween party when I was a kid and we all watched that.
Have you shown your daughter that?
I want to say yes. Okay. I think we watched it at one point. She's not a lot of those movies just like don't really grasp her. Okay. But she gets really into weird stuff. Like she just rewatched the entire series of Clarissa Explains It All.
Okay. She's the right age.
She loves that show.
Yeah.
And it's really weird for me to watch that show again.
Have you showed her like Pete and Pete?
I haven't had access to it to show it to her.
I can help you out with that. But, yeah, I mean, their Halloween episode is maybe my favorite Halloween episode of all time. Halloweenies.
Oh, yeah. Where he has to pretend that he's not going trick-or-treating.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because he doesn't want to get made fun of. Yeah.
How old were you when you stopped going?
Oh, probably 13.
Yeah, that's too old. But I was the same.
I think it was 12 or 13.
Yeah, I think about 10 or 11.
I remember specifically, actually, I was 12 because... The following summer I had my bar mitzvah.
Okay.
And I remember it
you're Jewish? What a way to find out, everybody. I'm kidding.
Well, I had an alien themed bar mitzvah.
An alien themed bar, is that allowed?
Yeah. Yeah. Every bar mitzvah is themed. One girl had a Titanic themed bar mitzvah.
Oh,
bar
that mitzvah. seems bad on a lot of different
Doesn't
levels.
That seem like bad taste a little bit?
Especially if she was a bigger girl.
No, she was just one of those girls obsessed with that movie.
Yeah, yeah.
And thought
dead.
And they put like the symbol on all the plates and stuff. Oh. It was really weird.
And then they drown everyone at the end.
Yeah.
That's a weird. Okay.
Yeah. Everybody had their thing. My brother's was Star Wars.
Okay.
Which is why I didn't get to do Star Wars.
So I had no idea that bar mitzvahs were themed.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Big deal.
So how was it alien themed? You just had the movie Alien or just general aliens?
General aliens. I was one of those kids obsessed with like the gray aliens.
Okay.
When that was a fad.
Red Light Communion and saw Fire in the Sky.
I definitely saw Fire in the Sky. Man, is that movie.
Oh God. When that membrane goes over and we can't breathe.
Yes.
I still have nightmares about that.
Actually, the one that really bothered me was when he's floating around and he flies into the one with the dead body in it.
Yes.
And it's like. All rotted. I was like, ah.
Were you watching stuff like Sightings and Unsolved Mysteries?
Oh, yeah.
And Alien Autopsy and all that stuff?
Not so much Unsolved Mysteries, but Sightings big time.
Yeah.
Big time. My brother and I, when we were little, we decided that we were going to hunt ghosts.
Okay.
And aliens.
Yep.
As a side.
Sometimes alien ghosts.
Yeah.
In Ghosts of Mars.
The ghost hunting files. We had like a file box. And we had like all our files and we would investigate things and pretend to investigate things.
Looking
we thought
for, like EVP and
we spied on our neighbors for months because we believed that they were aliens.
Okay. I was going to say, did you suspect that they were ghosts?
So we still refer to the house as the aliens house.
Were they just like Hispanic?
No,
that could go badly.
It was actually even stranger than that was that they were like the oldest family in the neighborhood. So it was a mother and father, and they had two sons who were like well into their late 20s, living at home. They were all firefighters.
Right.
The father and the two sons were firefighters.
That sounds pretty alien to me.
The one son looked like Matthew McConaughey in Dazed and Confused.
Okay.
And he would ride a unicycle around the street every once in a while.
Oh yeah, I would assume they were aliens.
Yeah, I mean, why wouldn't you?
Was there a house growing up that you dreaded going to on Halloween?
No. Really? Our neighborhood was pretty tame.
I mean, mine was tame as well, and I was out for hours. I hit up every house in Melrose.
Oh yeah.
And I had so much anxiety about it because the two things that terrified me were old people who invited you in. Because I just was very uncomfortable around old people, mostly because my grandmother was disgusting. And, you know, it'd be the old people with, like, whiskers on their face, and they were, like, smelled. And there was a lot of households in my town, and there's no way to say this without sounding like a horrible person, that had adult children who were mentally challenged, and they would... as an adult, I understand.
Yes.
You know,
I understand.
But as a kid, it is terrifying. Interacting with mentally challenged adults as a kid is terrifying. And I think part of that's primal. Like your lizard brain is like, they'll slow down the tribe or they're different or whatever it is. But
yeah.
And so they would always, it was like that person's night to shine, and they would let them hand out the candy.
Yep.
And they would want to like hug you and like look at your costume and tug on your face, and it was really like a gauntlet of terror for all the reasons that are not anything to do with Halloween. But I would have huge amounts of anxiety every year because, you know, you'd learn what houses they were. And you couldn't just skip the house, especially some of those, because that kid would, it would be, you know, he'd be so excited to hand out the candy and would just be like eager and waiting. And you could just walk past the house. I have nightmares and anxiety about that, and also combined with feeling bad about it.
Yeah, you can drive yourself crazy about things like
that.
So
you didn't have that problem.
I did. I can't remember that being the case at any point. You know, I mean, we lived in a neighborhood that was... we lived like right on the town border between my town and this other town, Medfield.
Okay.
And Medfield is a much, much like higher brow town.
All right. Full size candy bars?
No, nothing like that. But it was definitely like those were all like the nicer houses.
Yeah, yeah.
But nothing in that area was built like after 1983.
Oh, okay. So it's all new.
So it was like relatively new, but it was still rural. So it was like a solid, you know, a couple hundred feet between houses.
Oh, see, that seems like a lot more work. I got a lot of candy. I mean, I filled two king size pillowcases.
I think that any hesitations that I had would have been trumped by the fat kid desire to get free candy.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, I mean.
Well, this last year we took. Because do you and your wife take your daughter out now, or do you just want to?
Yes,
usually?
Yes, we do.
Yeah. And do you secretly love that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
When we first moved back to Massachusetts the first year, she. We went out trick-or-treating, and I was actually dressed up.
What'd you dress up as?
I was dressed as vampire.
Oh, nice.
Well, I was dressed as Dracula.
Nice.
It was before I had long hair and facial hair, so I was...
And back before you got the teeth filed.
Yeah, yeah. But she was... but that was like, it was one of those really fun situations where it's like, even the people who were handing out the candy were like, oh, give this one to your dad.
Yeah.
And things like that. And I mean, that's generally why I love... Halloween more than any other holidays. Like, there's no baggage.
Yeah, it's a nice, it's for someone who's a cynic, it's odd to say this, but it's a really nice sense of community.
Yes.
And oftentimes that's the only time all year you interact with most of those people in your neighborhood.
Yeah.
And it's and also as a kid I was very nosy about other people's houses. So I really like kind of peeking and seeing how they lived.
Such a creep.
I am a total creep. My favorite thing about the autumn is that it gets dark earlier. So when I go out for a walk at night and people have their lights on in their house, I can totally see in their houses and see what kind of decor they have. But last year, Rachel...
You and my wife should hang out
more. Oh, yeah. We love doing that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Open houses. Rachel's too English. She gets a little embarrassed about it. But last year, we took the dog out.
Yeah.
Trick-or-treating.
Oh, God.
We didn't go to houses.
Yeah.
But we dressed them up and then we just walked around all the neighborhoods and kind of... watched every, which sounds creepier than it is. We were watching all the kids trick-or-treat.
No,
because we get no one comes on our street.
Like, yeah.
We get no one on our street. So, but it was packed in all the other streets. And I wish we had started doing this earlier because it was such a nice kind of, it was a nice night. It was just like a nice thrill.
You gotta get Petey some like satchels that you put candy in and just give them out.
We do have a backpack for him that we could put candy in.
Yeah.
Yeah. And just be like a food truck for trick-or-treating.
Yeah. I mean, that'd be kind of fun for the kids too. Just be like, they can come up and see Petey and like get a piece of candy.
Get a piece of candy from the dog.
Yeah.
Yeah. That
unless
is
he would
good
steal
idea.
It back.
He's not a big candy guy.
Really?
Yeah. He mostly just likes pizza crusts. I did buy costumes for him and Teddy this year. And Teddy has a Wonder Woman dress that looks very good on him. Which I sent a photo of to my dad, who got very upset about it. And I told my father that Teddy picked it out himself. And he was like, "How? What do you do?" I'm like, "You know, he went right to it at the store." "Oh, well, I don't know about that." And we got PDA vampire costume. Looks real good. Yeah. So we're going to watch a movie tonight.
Yes.
We're going to watch Black Roses.
This is not a movie I've seen.
You've not seen this movie, but you suggested that we watch Rock and Roll Nightmare, which you've seen many times.
Yes. Early on in our friendship, you know, we bonded over the affection for that ridiculous movie.
Yeah. And Rachel and I watch that every New Year's Eve. That's our New Year's Eve movie. We watch it every New Year's Eve. At the stroke of midnight, he defeats the devil. John Fasano did that movie, who's sadly no longer with us. But he also made a movie called Zombie Nightmare, which was on MST3K, also starring Jon Mikal Thor. A movie called The Jitters, which is the only Western movie I can think of that has Chinese hopping vampires in it, which fascinates me.
The Seven Golden Vampires.
But
the Hammer one.
But that's a co-production with Shaw Brothers, so I don't count it.
Why wouldn't that count? Because it's still a movie.
But it's an Eastern. There's an Eastern production company behind it.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't know. Maybe I'll give you that one.
All right.
But it's a filmed in Canada. It's a decent movie. And this movie, Black Roses, and this particular movie is about a satanic heavy metal band, which aren't they all? And for some reason, having grown up in the 80s, I always associate heavy metal with Halloween.
Oh,
always.
Yeah.
And I never liked.
Well, you have movies like Trick or Treat.
Yeah.
And
The Gate.
Even like Motel Hell and.
Yeah. Yeah. It was just heavy metal and Halloween were just like.
Yeah.
And Headbangers Ball would do Halloween specials every year. They had one Headbangers Ball edition was hosted by Robert Englund as Freddy Krueger, which was very weird. Doc and Dream Warriors.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, yeah, that was the horror movie music for whatever reason. Which sounds a little silly now, but in the 80s, it absolutely was.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So this is about that sort of satanic panic where parents believed in backmasking and, Judas Priest got sued for having backmasking. And are you a fan of any of that kind of? I've come around as an adult.
I love Judas Priest.
Okay.
Right. They're one of those bands that I don't know. I feel so much more at ease liking them.
Yeah.
Because I kind of can... I know it sounds really weird, but it's like I kind of know where their politics stand.
Okay.
I mean, because Rob Halford is...
Yeah, they're not like a hateful, misogynistic group because he is a homosexual man.
Yes, and I think it's great that that so many people haven't, embraced that and just kind of gone along with it. And
I almost inadvertently said he came in the back door. But what I was going to say was he sort of tricked these metalheads into realizing that someone was okay by being like, hey, you like me, right? You've been my friend for like 10 years.
Yeah.
I'm gay. And they're like, whoa.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that was and he did it pretty early on, which I think is really, really neat.
Yeah. Oh yeah. He was one of the first out.
But I mean, heavy metal, that was definitely my college years was, because I started off in the punk rock scene and it slowly progressed into this.
You got into thrash stuff like Iron Maiden and that sort of stuff.
Iron Maiden was definitely the
gateway drug for a lot of punk rock kids.
Well, they have a very punk beat to their songs just with this much more theatrical kind of vibe, and then bands like Motorhead and
Danzig.
Oh,
what'd you think I said? Dancing.
Yeah.
You just got Danzig, but yeah, I mean,
well, Danzig, that's a Motorhead song.
That is too.
It's a great Motorhead
song. But Danzig, a lot of people get into the Misfits and then they kind of go.
I don't like any Danzig stuff.
There's one really great Danzig record spread out over 8 records.
I mean, the self-titled is okay.
There's three good songs on it.
It's okay.
What is it? Under Her Black Wings is great.
As many times as I heard it, Mother is a great song.
Yeah.
But oddly enough, I actually didn't get into the Misfits until late in my punk rock years.
Right.
Same thing with the Ramones, too, which it was one of those things where it's everybody always talked about the Ramones, but I just never really listened to them.
Well, the Misfits and the Ramones are weirdly very similar bands.
They are. Yeah. They're very, very much alone in the scene as far as there aren't any other bands that really come close to what they did.
No, and I think you go one of two paths when you kind of start off as a punk rock kid. You tend to move towards metal, or you move towards goth.
Oh, yeah.
Especially if you like horror stuff.
Well,
I always went towards the goth thing, because I was into the Cramps and, the TSOL and that kind of vein of punk rock.
I definitely went metal, but I mean, it was during a much more party heavy time.
Yeah.
So we would listen to a lot of metal records. And I mean, that was where Jon Mikal Thor came in.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that was I actually listened to Thor before I saw Rock and Roll Nightmare.
Yeah. You were listening to Bring the Dogs.
Yeah.
I mean that style of heavy metal too. I'm not talking about Pantera. I'm not talking about new metal.
No.
I'm not talking about that death metal, just, Napalm Death kind of stuff. And not cock rock, Poison.
Not.
There was bands like Wasp. And basically the Nightmare on Elm Street Part 5 soundtrack. Bruce Dickinson, Wasp, even some early Motley Crue. It kind of had this weird Satan, devil, thrashy, punky kind of thing going on. Slayer. Yeah.
Well, it was when it was like, it was dangerous.
Yeah.
Because that was what was appealing about punk rock to begin with, was that it was like, it was more dangerous.
But the metal was still more cartoonish. It sort of had that sense of fun.
And that totally appeals to my sensibilities.
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember in the 80s a lot of those bands had videos that had monsters in them, like Alice Cooper had a video.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Feed My Frankenstein.
Yeah, yeah.
The first time I heard that song when I was a kid, I was like, there's a song about Frankenstein?
Yeah. Or even like, you know, Godzilla from Blue Oyster Cult. Mm-hmm. And that kind of stuff is, you know, Don't Fear the Reaper is one of my favorite songs. Not a metal song, but I love it. So it was, this movie is I think the best of the heavy metal horror movies. And I first saw this movie on USA Up All Night. It was probably around 1990 or 91. It was on a double feature with a movie called Grotesque, starring Linda Blair, which never officially was released, that movie. It came out direct to television after it sat on the shelf for a couple of years. Tab Hunter was in it. It eventually came out on video later with a completely different ending that completely changes the movie. Really weird movie. And so I always equate these two movies for whatever strange reason. But it's a fun Canadian-lensed heavy metal is the devil movie, but doesn't have the bum-out nature of The Gate and doesn't have Mark Price's penis like Trick or Treat does. The full frontal nudity of Mark Price in Trick or Treat is unnecessary.
What's such a bummer about The Gate?
Well, because there's like the dog dies, which really makes me sad.
Yeah, okay.
The nerdy metalhead kid's mom died, and then he's like sees his mom in the vision, and he thinks that his mom's come back. And
the part that always got me was the worker in the wall.
Yeah,
that always creeped
that's
me
terrifying.
The fuck out.
Yeah, that's completely terrifying. And that movie is a very good horror movie. But some of it's, I don't want to say too real, but some of it is like disturbing in a way that a horror movie should be.
Yeah,
you know?
It's just slightly not cartoony enough.
Yeah, it's a little bit too good of a movie.
Yeah.
I want something a little more cartoonish or a little sillier. And I think that Black Roses is perfect for that because it is knowingly silly about a silly topic. The Satanic Metal Band is a silly topic. And the VHS tape of this was a video store staple, and it is a unique place in that it was a die cut three-dimensional blow mold sort of plastic form cover,
man.
Of the cover that was three, you know,
did it light up?
It lit up, the eyes lit up.
Yeah.
And it's right up there with the cover for
The Pit had
the Pit
that.
Yep.
Yeah.
Dead Pit. Yep. And Frankenhooker,
CHUD 2,
Bud the CHUD.
Yes.
Out on DVD,
but it had the CHUD 2 one had one of those vacuform covers that lit up as well, that had nothing to do with the movie.
No, that was a completely unrelated movie to CHUD. They bought that movie and reshot and revoiced some of it and made it a CHUD sequel. It was had nothing to do with CHUD. Shep Abbott, the guy that wrote CHUD, lives in Gloucester, Mass.
Yes, I've heard this.
And he's very, very unhappy with CHUD 2, Bud the CHUD.
I love the song.
Yeah, it's a fun song. Yeah. He has a full-size CHUD in his house.
Wow.
It's pretty impressive. This was a movie I've never seen in the theater. I've only seen it on television. It was, I saw it on Commander USA. I saw it on USA Up All Night. You've never seen it, but you're familiar with John Frazzano's oeuvre.
Yep.
Because you've seen Rock and Roll Nightmare. So we're gonna pause. We're going to watch Black Roses, and then we'll come back to get Sam Furst's reaction to Black Roses.
All right. Street.
All right, so we're back. We watched Black Roses. We were very disappointed.
I can't say that I was disappointed. I wasn't expecting all that much, but
it didn't live up to the first 3 minutes.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
The first 3 minutes were the most entertaining part of that entire movie.
Yeah, and they shot that after the movie was completed when they were back in New York. They shot that to kind of spice up the movie, which is why the demon designs are completely different.
Yo, yeah.
And it's it does kind of make you wait for, because you think that's a flash forward, but it's not.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's unclear as to what the demon's plan is.
Yeah.
His name is Damien.
Yeah, well, I mean, the impression that you get from that opening sequence is that the entire band is demons.
Yes.
Not just one demon and then his minions.
Yes.
And that they are either playing under the guise that it's just a show, like a gore type of a deal.
Yeah.
Or something to that effect. And then you proceed to get this like really weird kind of footloosey kind of.
Yeah, it's it is sort of a Footloose style movie.
Yeah, where all the parents are all up in arms about this, and then it, you know, but it, they end up being right, obviously.
Because then the kids kind of go a little Children of the Corn and murder all the parents. Although the first parental murder is much more fantastical.
Yeah, that was also another like really big tease, because you think that it's like this is how it's going to be going forward. It's going to be this like weird kind of supernatural, like biomechanical.
Yeah, it's kinda a little Cronenberg-y.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
Vinnie Pastore from The Sopranos plays one of the dads, a very homophobic, earring-hating dad.
Yeah, I mean, they're
what the fuck is this?
There's only two types of guys who have earrings.
Which my father said before.
Really?
Yes.
Did he ask you, did he say that there ain't no ship in the driveway?
Yep. And my grandfather, I have a freckle on my ear that looks like a pierced ear.
Yeah.
And my grandfather, the very angry, large Norwegian man, one day noticed it and was like, what the fuck is this? And was yelling at me about having my ear pierced, which I didn't.
Which you didn't.
Yeah.
See, my side of that is like totally, my mom encouraged me
to get
my ear pierced. So it was kind of.
Did you do one first or did you get both?
I did one first. And then.
I missed the single earring.
Yeah, I mean, like, that was such a 90s look.
I haven't seen a guy with just one earring in, I don't know, how long?
A little lopsided, you know? I don't know.
I don't know. I want someone to bring that. Someone's got to bring that back. Come on. Have some balls, gentlemen. And get one earring.
Do the pirate look.
Do the pirate look. I've seen people with eye patches. I haven't seen people with one earring.
Mm.
I think someone brave could pull that off. Vinnie Pastore gets the record turns kind of demonic and bubbly, and then he gets pulled into a speaker.
Yeah, there's
by like a speaker creature.
There's like veins and stuff coming on the speaker. And this puppet monster spider.
But then all the rest of the killings are just like hit with a car, punched to death.
Yeah, hit with a car from 5 feet away.
Yep, hit with an ashtray.
Thing.
Yeah, and then the teacher saves the day by burning everyone to death with flames.
Wearing a safety vest.
He's dressed like Marty McFly.
Yes, he is.
The whole last 10 minutes of the movie is dressed like Marty McFly.
But he's standing on the side of the stage.
No one's noticing while he's dumping gasoline all over the stage.
Yep.
Yeah, this is not the best John Frusciante movie, I will say.
No, it was... I mean, Rock and Roll Nightmare is not a good movie,
but that's a transcendent movie.
Yes, yeah. It's a movie that just has all these elements in it that cannot be explained.
This movie is missing Jon Mikal Thor.
Is that all it's missing?
Well, it could have a little
because
more
I mean, yeah, it's mostly honestly, it's just missing more of a demon band.
We need more demon band.
If there was more of that in it, I think it could have been okay. It would have been serviceable.
I once wrote a horror movie script, and this was to your point where we're watching it. You know, how do these bands form in hell? Would be funny.
Yeah,
where these demons come back to Earth and have like a cock rock band, thinking that they'll be able to win souls and get children and stuff, but everybody
about 10
hates them.
Yeah, they're like 10 years too late.
So they're playing like shitty bars for two people.
Oh, God.
And they're just playing
good.
Like, you know, like a good time billiards or that kind of stuff, or it's just like some old guy and they're like, what's happened?
I always had this really funny idea that what if somebody did a far future Terminator movie where the humans have been defeated?
Yeah.
What are the Terminators doing at that point?
Just hanging around,
just like standing around, like nothing to do, like looking for things to shoot.
Yeah, what's their end game there? They have no. Once they complete it, they have no function.
Yeah,
that's a good point. That's a good point.
Yeah,
I don't know why I said that like I was an Italian pizza maker. That's a good point. Oh, you make a good point, hey. Speaking of Vinnie Pastore, so you wouldn't watch this again, I assume.
I can't say that
because
it depends on the circumstances.
Yeah.
I think if it was like you and our good buddy Dan Wars.
Yeah, that would be fun.
You know, that would be a good time.
See it in a theater with a group of people.
Yeah. If it was at the Coolidge or something.
I don't mind the soundtrack in this movie. It's actually pretty
authentic. It's not bad. We were talking about where it was drawing some of its inspiration from.
Yep, we get a little Dokken in there.
Definitely Dokken.
A little Striper.
Yeah.
AC/DC. The guitar player, singer from Striper lives on the Cape.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
That's unfortunate.
It is. It is. For the cape and for him. Heavenly metal. Yeah, yeah.
To hell with the devil.
To hell with the devil. What is your favorite heavy metal album for Halloween?
Ooh. I might have to be a little cliche. I might say Number of the Beast.
Okay. That makes sense.
Or actually, you know what? No. I'll say Fear of the Dark.
Okay.
Because that's a little bit more spooky.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
It has some atmosphere to it.
Yeah.
And is there a thing that you have to watch every year for Halloween? Like, do you watch Great Pumpkin?
Definitely not.
You don't watch Great Pumpkin?
I'm not a Charlie Brown guy.
Neither am I, but Great Pumpkin and Charlie Brown Christmas are essential.
It was, well, the Charlie Brown Christmas is totally, I mean.
We already know you're Jewish.
Well, half Jewish.
Yeah. You should have.
I was raised Jewish, but I mean, we always celebrated Christmas because my mom was raised Catholic.
Right, right. Still can't get into Charlie Brown.
I just couldn't do it. I was always Christmas Story was always my go-to. For
okay,
that.
That's but a good one.
For Halloween nowadays, you know, I mean, with my kid, I end up watching. For a while, she was really obsessed with the Scary Godmother series. Which are actually a decent, like,
Jill
little
Thompson did the drawings, I think.
Maybe.
Yeah,
the original, the initial ones. Yeah. I'm a really big fan of Paranorman.
Okay.
That's kind of been one that I've gone to more recent days.
I've not seen that.
I relate to that movie a little too much. Like, he's a kid who, you know, people are writing loser on his locker and things like that.
He's a weirdo.
Yeah, he's a total weirdo and people treat him that way. And the funniest thing was that I can't remember if they do it in the movie, but they actually spell the word loser wrong, which actually happened to me.
Really?
Which was, somebody.
So you got picked on a lot for liking weird stuff or just being a weird kid?
Yeah, I was generally a weird kid. I had weird colored hair. I dressed differently and I listened to not normal music by everybody else's standards.
Number of the Beast.
And I was in a school that was very much sports oriented.
Yeah. Massachusetts.
Yeah.
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 What was your best Halloween costume, worst Halloween costume?
Ooh. Are we talking like kids or?
Yeah, kids. Adult, you have too many resources. It doesn't count.
When I was a kid, let me think.
So your Ghostbusters costume's probably up there, right?
That was like more of like an everyday thing.
Okay.
You know, like once I had that khaki jumpsuit, I wore that all the time.
Yeah.
I definitely had my proton pack all the time.
Well, you never know when you need it.
But I would say I one Halloween I was an Ewok.
Oh, nice.
We got this like fur jumpsuit that we borrowed from somebody. And I had a...
Someone had a fur jumpsuit that
It was a costume. I think it was a bear costume originally.
Okay.
But I got a Don Post Wicket mask.
Nice.
And there's a great picture of myself and my brother who was dressed as Jedi Knight Luke.
Oh, I think I've seen this photo. Yeah.
I may have showed it to you. And he's wearing... What's priceless about it, he's wearing like... my mom's like winter gloves and her black boots that had like black fringe on the back. But I mean, he's, you know, black turtleneck and everything.
That's what I'm missing about kids' costumes now is that kids can pretty much get any costume they want. That's pretty much movie accurate. And we had to sort of scrape together as best as possible from like women's clothing for the most part.
Yeah.
For most costumes.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm really guilty of that, this whole thing, because, I mean, as you saw, I go above and beyond for my daughter.
Yeah. Well, for you.
Well, it's definitely, I'm doing it because I wish somebody would have done this for little Sam kind of thing.
Right.
And so, you know, the first time we really, like, kind of, like, did anything with it was she wanted to be this character named Sabine from the new Star Wars series.
Okay.
And she decided to do this like a week before a costume contest at a screening for the show in Boston. And I'm like, listen, and it was, I think it was like early September.
Right.
So it was still pretty far off from Halloween. I'm like, listen, if I do this, you got to wear this for Halloween. She's like, absolutely. So I spent like the week busting my ass and I managed to make her Mandalorian armor and a helmet painted to be this character. She ended up winning the costume contest.
Nice.
And got like $100 Lego set nice. Out of it. So it was like really, really gratifying. And then the following year, she decided that she wanted to be a Jawa. Thank you mostly to David over at Kamikaze.
Yeah.
Because they got in a big discussion about Jawas, and he gave her a vintage Jawa figure.
Nice.
And she was like obsessed from that point forward. And
they reminded me too much of the little dwarves in Phantasm. That's what freaked me out about the Jawas. I'm thinking of the right thing.
Your reference was Phantasm first?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Phantasm really? First. Yeah, I saw Phantasm before I saw Star Wars.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Definitely. I mean, I don't remember not knowing Star Wars.
I'm that That's... way about Phantasm.
But so I made her a Jawa costume, and she, you know, light up eyes and everything.
Yeah.
And she ended up wearing it to Rhode Island Comic Con last year, which is where I met you.
Yeah, yeah.
And she wanted to walk around, and she started walking around. And my wife's like, I can't walk with her in this. She's getting stopped every 5 feet.
For photos. Should have charged some money. Oh,
you should have seen the strut in this kid's walk after that. Yeah. I mean, it was so funny.
What a world we live in now. From getting loser written on your locker spelled wrong, to dressing up as a Jawa and having people stop you, not to beat you up, not to chide you.
Yeah.
But to ask to have their photo taken with you because they're so impressed by your Jawa costume.
Yeah, I mean, it's a...
Unless they thought you was a dwarf from Phantasm.
It's true. Well, maybe that's still good.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, that's, you got another costume in there out of that.
That's
no
true.
Problem.
That's true. Yeah. She's not going to be that short for that much longer.
You got to do Phantasm Dwarf. Yeah. I imagine you haven't shown her Phantasm.
No.
That's a movie I like to watch at Halloween.
We did watch last New Year's Eve. We watched Terminator 2.
Yep.
Which she covered up for the two scenes that I thought were cringeworthy.
Okay.
Which is the when the T-1000 disposes of John Connor's stepdad.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Or our foster dad.
Yep.
And the cop.
Yeah.
Those are the only two moments. Like, everything else is actually relatively tame.
Yeah.
Because there's not gore.
That movie's much more tame than the first one.
It's more of an action movie. It's a kind of like, it's no worse than any superhero movie.
Yeah.
That's out right now.
I not to get on a Terminator 2 tangent, but everyone cites that as a sequel better than the original, and I still like the original better.
I like the original as a horror movie.
Yeah, it has.
Do you
that
know what
vibe.
I mean?
Yeah, and
which
and the weird score, and it's got that. It just has a much sleazier downtown '80s LA kind of vibe.
Oh yeah, and I mean the same thing goes for Alien. The first Alien movie and the first Terminator movie, for all intents and purposes, those are horror movies.
Well, Alien,
those aren't sci-fi.
Oh yeah,
movies.
Absolutely. I mean, I always cite sci-fi is not a pure genre, and that it has to be mixed with something else to make a movie.
Yeah,
so the Alien movie is the best example because the first one's a haunted house movie, second one's a war movie, the third one's a prison movie.
Yeah,
you know, they just happen to have a sci-fi element in them. But the original Terminator, it could be a demon instead of a, you know, a machine.
Yeah, yeah.
But it has, there's just a vibe to it that I
Well, it's really gruesome. He's really, he doesn't talk much.
There's no humor in it. There's no hasta la vista, baby. In it.
There's no taglines. There's no
Danny Cooksey.
There's no chill out, dickwad.
Yeah,
that's my favorite.
Yeah,
but Terminator 2 is just one of those. It's like this. It's like on the verge of a perfect movie.
Yeah,
and it's just because it's. I don't know. It's like bottling lightning.
It's a big spectacle with a good story too.
Yeah, it's one of those movies where it's like there's no reason that this should be as good and enjoyable as it is. It's so weird.
Yeah, that movie's the first huge sequel I remember being a big deal because Star Wars was done for all intents and purposes.
Yep.
It was done. Indiana Jones, I think Last Crusade came out in 89 maybe, but that was still kind of seen as a little bit niche and like older people liked it.
Yeah.
And Terminator 2 was everywhere. The merchandising was everywhere. The video games were everywhere.
Yeah.
It was on everything. There was a making
of.
Well,
I mean, that was the Batman.
Yeah.
You know, syndrome too, which was after the 89 Batman movie. Every sequel after that got crazy amount of attention.
But even though but I think Terminator 2 came out before Batman Returns, right? Because Batman Returns was 92 as well, or they came out the same summer.
Terminator 2 is 94.
Terminator 2 is 92.
Is it?
Yeah. Batman Returns is 92 as well.
Okay.
Terminator 2 might even be 91, but I think it's 92. So I think they came out the same year, but yeah, they were the sequels. So Terminator 2 was just, that was 94's Jurassic Park. That okay. was a huge movie.
Yeah.
But for sequels, you know, it was almost 10 years after the original, and it was
yeah.
Definitely more people saw part two than part one.
Yeah. Well, it was a much more commercial friendly movie.
Family friendly.
Well, I mean, not even family friendly, but it's like you have a young protagonist.
Yeah.
Which will appeal to kids.
Yeah.
You had, oh, let's not forget that there was a killer toy line.
Yeah. The toys were fantastic.
I had all of those.
Even the arm that you could get.
Oh, the awesome arm?
Yeah. And Linda Hamilton was a huge star, mostly because of Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah.
She had just left that show. I think it was on for 4 seasons, and it just ended when she went into Terminator 2. And was a huge, huge television star at that time.
But she, and then she went on to like nothing.
I don't think she wanted to do much after. Well, she was in Chuck. She was in Chuck as his mother.
Oh, that's right. She showed up in that.
Yeah. Yeah, but she doesn't come up in things that often. She has a twin sister.
I know that.
Which I learned in the making of.
Yeah.
Which is very exciting.
Well, my favorite thing about that making of was the first time that I found out about deleted scenes.
Yes.
Because that was something that I had never even thought about. I was like, no, they just filmed the movie start to finish.
Yeah.
What are you talking about? And then they show the whole sequence of the mirror with Linda Hamilton's sister.
They had an extensive coverage of the deleted scenes when the laser disc of T2 came out, and they reviewed it on Siskel and Ebert. I remember them talking about all the deleted scenes because the laser disc version of T2 was like another 20 minutes or something.
Wow.
And that was really odd.
And unheard of, yeah.
Yeah. So there isn't really a thing that you're like, every Halloween we have to watch this or it's not the same?
No, I mean, as you can imagine, Halloween time, while it is a sacred time.
Yeah, it's busy for you.
It is extraordinarily busy for me. I set up my booth in Salem every year, and that is my goal. But also, I mean, my wedding anniversary is Halloween.
You got married on Halloween?
We got married on Halloween.
We got married in October for that reason, but not on Halloween.
Yeah, I kind of wish we hadn't done Halloween, because now with our daughter, it's like we don't get to do anything for us. It's like we're not going to ditch her on Halloween.
We could,
but we're not going to.
That would be scary for her.
But I mean, it's also, while it is a chaotic time for me, it's also the most relaxing to a certain extent, where I love the weather.
Yeah.
And I just feel a little bit more at ease.
Yeah, same here. And I wonder how much of that is because we're into this kind of thing, or part of it is, I think we're, you know, growing up in New England, the weather really is, the October weather is that the air smells different. There's a Christmas to it, crispness, not a Christmas. And it definitely has a different vibe.
Yeah.
And it's very comforting in a weird way. And Salem, which we've kind of neglected to talk about here, is essentially the New Orleans for Halloween.
Oh yeah.
It is great. I didn't know, growing up so close to Salem and going there all the time, that it's a big deal nationally.
Well, but see, I have that whole, I'm from Massachusetts. Why would I go to a tourist spot in Massachusetts?
Oh, really? So you never went?
We never went when I was a kid. It was just not something we went. It wasn't until I met my wife, who, you know, was from out of state, and she was like, let's go to Salem. I'm like, all right. And we went up to Salem, and I mean, like, I love that town.
It's great. It's great. It's in, and again, I think people forget that we're in this world now where you can buy Halloween stuff all year round.
Yep.
For us as kids, you maybe had one or two costume stores that were always a far drive. I don't know why. Even if you live with the town, there was always, you had to drive to a costume store or had to wait for the drugstore to start selling some Halloween stuff.
Yeah.
You didn't get horror
Paperama.
Movies all year round. Paperama was fantastic. Where was your Paperama? Which was the one in Somerville? Was the
The one in Dedham.
Yeah, Paperama was...
I actually got a Batman Forever mask there.
Nice. Because they went out of business around 97, probably, when Paperama went
into. I think that was last year.
Yeah, Paperama was sort of like a Staples, but also mixed with like an iParty. And it was local.
It was paper goods.
Yeah, paper goods. But they were the Halloween headquarters every year.
Yep.
But you didn't have things that were sort of themed horror all year round. And Salem is. It really is. It has, I mean, it's a little kitschy occasionally, but, you know, there's gargoyles and old burying grounds, and it's a town built their whole economy is built around witches.
Yeah.
And it's fun, horrific that it is, best not, but if you like this stuff, it's fantastic.
Oh, it's a great town. And I mean, for me, I think much like with conventions, you know, if I didn't have like a home base, like a setup where I can be outside of the crowd.
Yeah.
I don't know that I would enjoy it as much as I do because it gets packed.
It gets packed. It absolutely does. Like the whole month of October there.
Yep.
It's a madhouse. But I like going there, you know, in September or November too, mm-hmm. because you kind of still get the same atmosphere. But it is fun during October because every weekend, you know, and you have a booth there selling mm-hmm. your stuff. There's like all vendors. There's, you know, all the sort of carnival foods. There's like, it's like a carnival with no rides and really nothing going on.
Yeah. Actually, there is a carnival that goes on.
Oh, they have a carnival now?
Yeah, it's right off of Derby Street. Weird. Like right around the corner from where Count Orlox is, there's okay. usually a carnival set up.
And there's tons of haunted houses. Like there's like 12 haunted yes. houses there. Wax Museum, like all these different.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and I'm biased towards my buddy's museum, Count Orlok's Nightmare Gallery, which, yeah. I mean, have you been there?
I have. And I went to the Boris Karloff 3D one at one point, too.
Yeah, that's a long, yeah. long time ago.
Yeah.
He actually had some pieces from their setup that were, like, just kind of, like, thrown into the museum.
Yeah, yeah.
James, who runs Count Orlok's, I mean, he does a phenomenal job of lighting and generally, like, putting a nice set
yeah,
together.
Yeah.
He does, the museum turns into a haunted house in October.
Yeah.
I like it just as a museum.
Yeah. I enjoy the museum as well. There's some really cool replicas of like famous
yeah.
monsters in there and some memorabilia stuff.
Well, he does, he gets heads from different artists, for the different figures. And then he yeah. finishes them and builds the bodies and builds the sets and
it's like the movie Waxwork.
Yeah.
It is, except they don't come to life and kill you.
Yeah.
But it, yeah, it really is. If you like, you know, horror stuff, it's a whole city of horror stuff.
Yeah.
Which probably doesn't sound quite as exciting now, but it really is. And it was always weird as a kid because Salem was on TV a lot. They did an In Search of episode about Salem. Elvira hosted MTV 2 Halloweens in a row from Salem. They did a whole day in Salem and it was really bizarre. You know, Bewitched filmed 3 episodes in Salem, and it was sort of our only connection to anything Hollywood also, because they would film stuff there. But it's fun. I always try to go there in October when I can, if you can get, I mean, it is difficult to get in and out. You kind of, yeah, I imagine you have to get there.
Yeah. I mean, we start loading in at, I usually aim to get there like 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning. But you know, I get to get there, I set up, I park my car, and then I'm in my tent until the street opens up again, when I can drive my car back to where I was
right.
load up. And other than that, I mean, I'm standing out in October weather drinking hot apple cider.
Yeah, that's
pretty great. You know, and talking to people, and it's one of my favorite events to do.
Yeah, and people are in costume all year, you know, all month, and it's fun. Yeah, that, I guess if you have that every year, you don't necessarily need to have like a go-to watching thing for Halloween. Although, speaking of Ghostbusters, the real Ghostbusters does have one of my favorite Halloween episodes.
Oh, yeah.
And I watch it every year. And it's called When Halloween Was Forever. I think Michael Straczynski wrote it.
You know, I may have to dig that one up because my daughter loves the Ghostbusters cartoons.
It's a great one.
And
with Samhain.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they did a return of him in
yes.
in the Extreme Ghostbusters.
Yes, it's not as good though.
The Extreme Ghostbusters is actually a really good show.
It is, but I don't like the, I didn't like the one with Samhain quite that much because
yeah.
that was such a good character in the.
Yeah.
What a terrifying! If you're only gonna watch one Halloween thing, oh gee, that's tough actually.
Yeah.
But it would be the Halloweenies.
Yeah.
Or the real Ghostbusters When Halloween Was Forever, because it's a giant pumpkin-headed terrifying monster. It's fantastic. Yeah.
Have you ever watched The Halloween Tree?
Yes.
That's a really twisted one.
I read the book because I love Ray Bradbury.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But the animation on it is a little too 90s for me.
I can see that.
If I'm going to watch, even though it's not set at Halloween, I watch Something Wicked This Way Comes every year because that is such an autumnal, like that movie looks like Salem feels.
Yeah.
And that's the perfect Ray Bradbury Halloween thing.
Well, Paranorman, which I was talking about, actually takes place in Massachusetts.
Of course.
And it's not Salem, but it is Salem.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's this whole town that's built on an economy around, like, these horrible events that happened in the past. And it kind of comes back, but this, that's a, if you haven't watched that.
I'll have to see that. I haven't watched it.
The animation is amazing.
Okay. Paranorman's on my list. I've tried to rewatch Hocus Pocus. I know that's beloved by people. I went and saw them film a lot of it because they filmed it in Salem. Mm. It's just okay. I think it's a little bit overrated.
I'm with you on that. Yeah. I really am. I enjoy it. And I mean, it has one of my favorite creature actors in it.
Yeah.
Doug Jones.
Yep. Who you may know from the Hellboy movies.
He's Abe Sapien.
Yep.
But he's, I mean, he's in everything. He's actually one of the gentlemen in the Buffy episode.
Oh, yeah.
He's on The Strain now. Very, he's on Falling Skies.
Gentleman.
Yes.
Yeah. Plays the zombie in Hocus Pocus.
My wife and my daughter actually met him at Rhode Island Comic Con last year when she was wearing her Jawa costume.
Excellent. Excellent.
And she was very excited about meeting him.
Yeah. I always like that movie, too, because I can't think of his name. The main kid in it, who's also in Erie, Indiana. And I was a huge Erie, Indiana fan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My favorite thing about that is that he's like from California.
Yes.
And the local Salem kids are like making fun of him for being from California.
That's accurate. That would happen if you were fucking California. It would be a little bit different.
Yes. Well, they're making fun of him for not smoking.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
You're from California. You don't smoke.
Yeah.
Like
accurate.
Yeah.
My dad lived in Salem for a long time. He lived in an old schoolhouse and he was convinced that it was haunted. And he was convinced that it was haunted. And this, I'm not making this up. He was convinced that it was haunted by the ghost of a gay teacher who would watch him shower. Yeah.
Yep. I don't even know how to respond to that.
No, we didn't either. He would go on and on about it.
But that sounds like a new script idea.
Yeah, he was adamant about
a
it.
A gay teacher ghost.
Yeah. No, I know. He hasn't done nothing. He just watches you while you're showering. And he wasn't kidding. He was serious. Yep.
I really feel like that needs to be made into something.
That sounds like a sitcom. It's like a sitcom.
That could be a really, really...
It's like a new Odd Couple.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, again...
and the Gay Ghost.
Me and the Gay Ghost. It would be like Funky Phantom.
Yeah.
So, the real Ghostbusters from Halloween was Forever. Pete and Pete Halloweenies. Those are essential. You got any that you want
to
add
I'm trying to think of good Halloween episodes that...
Night of the Living Dead always aired on Halloween every year. That one, that's a movie I generally will watch.
You know, Ernest Scared Stupid's still pretty high up there.
I agree.
Just because of nostalgia reasons.
But it's not a bad movie.
Oh, you know what movie I've been meaning to revisit is Spaced Invaders.
Yeah, that was my recommendation today. So I'm doing 31 recommendations for Halloween movies all month, one every day.
Yeah.
And today's was Spaced Invaders.
Well, when I was a kid, I was obsessed with her Xenomorph costume.
Yeah.
I was like, how did she make that?
Yeah.
You know,
that's a good movie. It's a fun movie.
I haven't seen it in so many years.
It's worth revisiting. It's fun.
I definitely want to revisit that one because that come to think of it, that was another one that was always in rotation.
Yeah. That's a good movie. It's a harmless movie. It's funny. It's appropriate for children.
Yeah.
Has a great Halloween atmosphere and is an interesting take on the War of the Worlds thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As far as like more modern movies, where do you go? Are you a fan of Trick or Treat?
Trick or Treat was okay. I didn't like all the segments. I didn't like
but you love
Sammy. I love a portmanteau. I love an anthology series.
Yeah.
I liked some of the atmosphere. I liked some of the look of it, but it didn't really hit with me that well. There's a movie called Satan's Little Helper that is Jeffrey Lebowitz, who did Squirm and Remote Control.
I know the cover of it.
Yeah, that's actually really good. It's unfortunately shot on video, so it doesn't look as cool as it should, but it's actually a really good movie. That's from the 2000s. Trick or Treat. Not Trick or Treat. Fun Size. Fun Size is a Nickelodeon-produced film. It's a comedy. It's a teen comedy set on Halloween, and it's really, really good. It's from maybe 2-3 years ago. That I love. That's a really good movie. What else is there that's more modern? That's all I can think of for somewhat recent things.
Yeah. Yeah, there hasn't really been a whole lot.
There's some good more recent shows, like Supernatural actually has a really good Halloween episode with Samhain in it. you know, there's I think it's the Goldbergs does some decent Halloween
episodes. Yeah, I love I'm a huge Goldbergs fan.
Yeah. Oh, there's been great Halloween episodes of Community.
Yeah, Community always did good ones. They were like really off the wall though.
Yeah.
A couple of them.
Oh yeah, with the zombies.
Yeah, the zombie one. Yep. The
and, former guest of the show and friend Eric Charles Nielsen dressed as a zombie hamster.
Nice. Oh, Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
They've had good Halloween episodes.
Yeah, they do good Halloween episodes.
Okay, I'll have to check those out.
That was a show that I was really resistant to, but then I kind of just like started watching it and I thoroughly enjoy it.
I mean, Roseanne always had the classics. They had great Halloween episodes. Home Improvement on a Halloween episode every year always was just as bad as regular Home Improvement.
I know your feelings on it. It was one of those things that was like a staple though.
Yeah.
For
You're younger than me. I think that's probably a difference too.
I'm not that much younger than you, but
you're younger enough that Home Improvement wasn't horrible.
I mean, looking back, it's horrible.
Yeah.
But when I was a kid, it was, you know, it's the whole Urkel thing as well, where it was just like, it was standard.
Yeah, it was cool to have a Halloween episode on because it was unusual. Yeah. And they did one every year and you knew you'd get one every year.
Yeah.
Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place did a Halloween episode every year. And that show was on for like 6 seasons, which I think people forget, which is very, very strange.
Ryan Reynolds
read off a 15 into Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place. Yeah. And then just Two Guys and a Girl, set in Boston, set in Somerville, actually.
Really?
Yeah, it's supposed to be Peenie's Pizza on Broadway in Somerville, which looks a lot like penis pizza when it's written. And we used to order from there all the time.
What are you ordering? Penis pizza.
I have a large penis pizza. I also very much enjoy the Halloween episodes of Night Court. They would do one every year, and Cheers did one almost every year as well, which were always pretty exciting. The Bar Wars episodes were usually Halloween episodes.
I guess, I mean, TV was always something. I mean, I always watched TV, but I guess I always lean towards movies, though.
Yeah, I mean, I love the seasonalness of holiday episodes.
Yeah, absolutely.
It seemed very now. So
oh, you know who does great ones? Atmosphere. Phineas and Ferb.
I haven't seen those.
Those are some, I mean, Phineas and Ferb is one of those shows that, like, it's far more clever than you would ever imagine it to be.
Huh, I'll have to check those out.
And they do some really great classic monster references.
Okay.
That I really, really enjoy.
There's a Fat Albert Halloween special. God. That is probably the best episode of Fat Albert, but it has my favorite line in it where they decide they're going to scare this old dude. And then he's like, hey, what did he ever do to you? Why are you going to scare him? And he goes, because he got old. That's his only crime. But that's pretty exciting as well. Do not, under any circumstances, watch the Alvin and the Chipmunks Halloween special because it will break your heart.
Did you see the Alvin and the Chipmunks Meet the Wolfman?
Yes, I did, yes.
And Alvin and the Chipmunks Meet Frankenstein?
Yes, those are not the ones I'm referring to.
Yeah, but those ones actually aren't too bad.
Those aren't too bad. But the episode of their show that was a Halloween, it's really sad. There's like a deformed child who everyone makes fun of. It's brutal. It's brutal. Yeah.
That's.
Yeah. Unnecessary.
Yeah.
Unnecessary.
I don't know.
Yeah. I know the kids are cruel, but we don't need to know that.
Yeah.
In our media. So those would be my recommendations if people are looking for something to watch on Halloween that might be a little different. Always, you know, you have Halloween, the perennial favorite is a classic.
Yeah.
For some reason, WSBK TV 38 around here would always do Friday the 13th marathons on Halloween,
well,
which I don't think are good Halloween movies.
No. I think that when you're watching movies at Halloween time, because, I mean, I watch horror movies all year round.
Yeah, same.
I mean, that's the thing, is that a lot of people just watch horror movies in October.
Yeah, it's like people who just give money to the homeless at Christmas.
Yes, exactly. I don't know that you could compare those two things.
Same thing.
At any time, but yeah, it's a very like fair weather kind of fandom. But, you know, so I watch monster movies and horror movies all year round.
Yeah.
So when it comes to October, it's like I'd like something that gets me a little bit more in the Halloween mood.
Yeah, it has to be seasonally appropriate. Because, like, yeah. Friday the 13th movies, those are summer movies. They're summer camp movies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Honestly, I think that the new Ghostbusters will probably make its way into rotation.
Yeah.
You know, it's supposed to be taking place in the fall.
Yeah.
And
I enjoyed that quite a bit.
And it feels like a made-for-TV kids Halloween movie.
Very ABC Family.
Yeah. And I mean, I liked it a lot.
Yeah.
Other than that, I mean, yeah, I will probably end up watching The first two Halloween movies.
Ernest Scared Stupid.
Ernest Scared Stupid, possibly.
I watch Elvira, Mistress of the Dark every year. It's very Halloween-y. Yeah.
That's a good
one. Takes place in Massachusetts. Yeah, it's supposed to be in Turner's Falls, Mass, or something like that. It's a Falwell. It's a made up town in Massachusetts. Yeah, it's like small town New England, sort of fuddy duddies. Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of off the beaten path Halloween stuff to watch. Don't watch Friday the 13th. Don't just watch any horror movie.
Yeah,
put some thought into it.
I think Monster Squad would probably be a good one too.
Monster Squad's a really good
one. Which you and I will have the chance to watch on a moderately larger screen.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Monster Squad is a classic one. I mean, I watch that movie several times a year anyway, but yeah, you get all your monsters in there. It seems autumnal in that they're in school.
I mean, there's leaves blowing around and stuff. It's fall.
Yeah, absolutely. You know,
it's not necessarily Halloween, but it is fall.
Yeah, for sure. And even though I enjoyed it when I saw it in the theater, Nightmare Before Christmas, not very Halloween-y.
No, it's a Christmas movie.
It's a Christmas movie.
It's a Christmas movie.
And that's a classic debate. Is it a Christmas movie or is it a Halloween movie?
It's a Christmas
movie. It's a Christmas movie, everybody. So do not watch that for Halloween. Also want to recommend Lady in White. If you haven't seen that movie, it's fantastic. Set in the 1960s. It's like a mixture of the Wonder Years with a really creepy ghost story.
Would you ever go to Pet Semetary 2?
I enjoyed Pet Semetary 2 because it was so ridiculous. Mm. It didn't have the terrifying nature of the first one. Like Anthony Edwards, Clancy Brown, always good in everything. Yep. And it's fun to see Eddie Furlong in something that's not brain scan.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's Halloween in that one too.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Not a lot of King stuff said at Halloween, weirdly. Can't think of any.
It's a little
others.
Too on the nose, you know.
Maybe.
I mean, I would imagine that he puts a little bit of thought into the fact that it's like, you know, horrible stuff happens all year round.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
although Salem's Lot feels very Halloween-y to me. That I'll watch every year. That is a made-for-TV movie that is terrifying. Still scares the shit out of me.
The Mr. Barlow makeup is so good.
Terrifying. The floating friend in the
window.
Yeah,
the kid.
It's the
glowing eyes. It's just
the
so...
glowing eyes. Oh, yeah. I mean, there's so many just hauntingly terrifying things in that movie that made for TV. There's about 10 things I've said I think are the best thing Tobe Hooper ever did. But I think that the Salem's Lot made for TV movie, that two-part movie, is definitely up there. Because that is horrifying.
That is a very good one.
And again,
it's a long one.
It's long. It's 4 hours. But I mean, again, back there is a 2-hour edit that they released in Europe theatrically. Mm. But you know, back to what we were talking about when we first started talking today, the fact that the TV stuff has restrictions on it made that stuff a lot more impactful and scary to me, which is why things like Don't Be Afraid of the Dark or, you know, the anthology horror stuff. Or...
I was obsessed with Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Yeah.
I mean, that was that came along. That was like the first time I got to stay up like relatively late.
Right. 9:30. It was on at 9:30 on Nickelodeon.
Ten. Yeah. We got a 10 o'clock bedtime on Saturday nights because we would watch SNICK.
Yeah,
and
some of those hold up. Those are fun.
Oh yeah,
yeah. I rewatched those. I rewatched Tales from the Dark Side. I rewatched Monsters.
We went back. We watched all the Goosebumps.
Yeah, the Goosebumps
shows, with Ryan Gosling.
In
one of them, and those ones don't hold. Those are a little bit more. I don't know. They're pretty dated feeling.
You know what? I don't know. I probably won't be able to find them tonight. I have no idea if you want them, but I at a yard sale over the summer got a crate of every Goosebumps book for $1. I have no idea what to do with them. I'm not going to read them.
Page May.
So yeah.
Yeah.
I'll pass those along.
Did you see the new Goosebumps movie?
No, is it good?
It's actually quite enjoyable. And that is another kind of Halloween time movie that would be actually pretty good.
I'll have to check it out.
It is very much in vain of all those like Halloween kids movies that they don't make anymore, really.
We're also neglecting E.T. Technically a Halloween movie.
Yeah, technically, if you want to slit your wrists.
It's a Halloween movie in the way that Gremlins is a Christmas movie.
Yeah. Well, we actually watched that not that long ago.
E.T.?
Yeah.
Well, that's a bum out of a movie.
Yeah, well, phew.
Yeah.
But it also is, it's one of those movies that it's like, watching it now, I'm like, wait a minute, what the hell is going on?
Yeah, there's a lot. You know what's really weird is where we always stay when we go to L.A. Uh-huh. is the neighborhood where they filmed
really?
All the trick-or-treat scenes from E.T.
Yeah.
And so even though we'll be in L.A. and it's summertime or it's really nice, it always feels slightly Halloweenish to me because we're in that neighborhood.
Yeah. My favorite thing about watching that movie this last time that I watched it, which, I mean, I haven't watched that movie in probably 20 years.
Yeah.
And we watched it. And aside from like the so obviously 80s like kids interactions.
Yeah.
Where I believe he calls his brother boner breath.
Penis breath.
Penis breath.
Yeah. And actually, funny story, they showed that to us in school once on like a Friday before vacation. Because that's what they do. And I don't even know if they do this now in elementary school. It was like, oh, it's the Friday before vacation. So we just watch movies. So we had to get a permission slip signed by our parents to watch it.
Yeah.
And the permission slip specifically stated the reason that they needed to give us permission was because the term penis breath was in the movie. So I had to bring home a slip of paper that said, is it okay for my kid to hear the word penis breath?
I love that they would put it on the flyer.
Oh yeah.
I really wish you saved that.
God, I wish it would have been amazing.
Yeah. But my favorite part of watching that is the scene when they're walking around the neighborhood, because as you know, I mean, I'm a big Halloween nerd and I collect old Halloween costumes and masks.
There's
and
a
stuff.
Lot of Ben Coopers.
So there's so just like looking at all the masks and stuff, and I know where some of these come from, and it's just really fun to see them kind of in action. And it's just neat.
And at the correct time.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff.
Oh, I mean the great, you know, there's the kid walks by dressed as Yoda.
Yep.
And then there's the whole, there's like this whole connection thing where they threw E.T. into one of the prequels.
Yeah.
He's part of like the Galactic Senate. And so then they're like, yeah, but see, then he sees Yoda on the street and he recognizes him. So he goes to start talking to him and then like they pull him away.
Yeah.
But, the other thing that I just thought of was, have you ever seen The Guest?
No.
So this is a movie that came out and went like it
recent.
Was last like 2-3 years.
Okay.
I had no interest in watching this movie. It looked like a really weird, like this family's son dies in the war and his buddy who was there with him, like comes and stays with the family and kind of helps them get their shit together.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not at all like that.
Okay.
That's how it's presented. That's how the previews presented it.
Yeah, yeah.
It is the most crazy movie.
Okay. I'll have to check out The Guest.
It takes place at Halloween time.
Excellent.
That's why I'm bringing it up.
Okay.
And if anybody out there has not watched this movie, watch it.
Okay.
Don't look up anything about it. Just go into it.
All right.
And it's got some awesome surprises in it, and the soundtrack is awesome.
All right. So The Guest is also on the list. We've given you a list, quite a list, and you have a couple weeks for Halloween, so you have plenty of time to watch all this stuff. Also, I am posting, you know, the movie recommendations every day. But thank you so much for doing this, and we will enjoy the rest of our October in a very Halloween-y way.
Yes, thank you so much for having me.
There you go, Sam Furst, great guy, go to Monsters Are Good, purchase many monster paraphernalia, and wear them to Chris Hardwick's show on Friday, November 4th, that you will buy tickets for, because this show is brought to you by Chris Hardwick, The Idiot Tour, at the Wilbur Theater, November 4th, two big shows, 7:30 p.m. and 10 p.m. Go to thewilbur.com for tickets and information. Anyway, I had a lot of fun talking Halloween, and I always love talking Halloween. If you have traditions or things that you watch every year, let me know. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. Love hearing from you guys. Or go to our Facebook page, TV Guidance Counselor. Just search there and share it with us there. Go to Monsters Are Good and purchase some fine, fine monster things from Sam Furst. Have a safe, healthy, happy Halloween. Wear your reflectors. Don't eat apples. You can eat them on, you know, before and after Halloween, just not on Halloween night. And we'll see you again Wednesday for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
I had an